This is the March 27, 2019 meeting of the Finance Committee. Our agenda tonight is continuing to review budgets, including CIP. We've got the town clerk in for her budget, including the elections budget, and the school department is in to cover their budget, and additionally, we'll be looking at the Norfolk agricultural budget and the Bay Path budget as part of that. So although the agenda looks brief, there's a lot of money we'll be talking about tonight, so it should be a great conversation. We don't have any changes to our, let's just say, our surplus of about $70,000-ish at this point, so Ed, I'll keep the microphone from you for an extra minute, if that's all right. Let's get right into the town clerk budget. Deb, can you come on up? And let's go over the operating budget first, and I believe you got one item on the CIP, so we'll go over that, too, for a quick discussion. First off, your town clerk budget requests the, just got the revision tonight on that, $175,671. This is a town manager recommendation, which represents a 2.62% increase over prior year. If you could just give us a brief on what's going on with the town clerk's budget.
Town clerk's budget is pretty much the same every year, other than the salaries. I have included for my assistant to send her to the New England Institute of Clerks. It's a three-year program, one that I graduated from in 2015. So I'd like her to go to that starting this summer. So I included that balance. It's a $925 increase in education.
Okay. With that, I'll open up to questions. Anything on this budget? Do a motion on it.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So voted. Okay. And while we're here, let's do the elections, and then we'll go back to your CIP, okay? So the elections budget, I requested $21,585. This is a reduction of just under $7,900 from the prior year. I'm sure that has to do with the number of elections, and I can't remember from year to year what's
Last year, we had three elections. In fiscal 2020, we'll have two elections with a presidential primary in March. I did not include early voting. Right now, there is a bill in the Senate to possibly have 5 days of early voting. So I did not include that possibly in October. If we know by then, I would include that to have the 5 days of early voting for that. But other than that, there's only two elections for this.
Would the early voting be an additional expense? Yeah, okay, just so we're clear on that.
Yes, for the precinct workers, there isn't any way to run it through the office with the staff, so I hire the poll workers to work it, and then we have to advertise for it and anything else that the Secretary of State's office in elections comes up with.
Okay.
But so far, they're figuring for 5 days, where typically early voting is only in biennial years, but because people, it seems to go over well and gives the voter another chance to vote.
That's always good.
Introducing that.
Great. Any questions on this budget?
Motion to approve.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? So voted. Thank you. Okay, let's go back to the CIP for the town clerk. My recollection is there's one item on there. And Deb, while we've got it, correct me if I'm wrong, are we changing our approach to taking care of the hieroglyphics in the basement kind of thing? Can you explain what's going on with that?
Well, there's records everywhere, here, there, and everywhere. We have the vault that has the records. On the third floor, there is records from many different departments. And then when the Marion building was done over, there were records that were in the basement that were brought over to Mary D. School. And since that school has been sold, they were brought over here, and they were in the hallway because we didn't have a place to put them. So King Information, we did an assessment of all the records, and they came up with, you know, a plan to go through all the records, index all the records, see what we had to keep in the retention for the records, and everything will be indexed, and we'll know where the records are, because when you're looking for a record now, unless it's in the vault, and the people that have the stuff that's in there, they know where that stuff is, but the stuff that's in the attic, there's many different records up there, and nobody knows where it is, and they're searching when they're looking. So we have a plan in place that they already did a little of it, and if this gets approved at town meeting, it will be finished in either the summer or fall.
If I can add to that.
Sure, thank you.
And thanks, Deb. This is a new records management system. It does come with a software package that allows us to index it and find records very quickly. King did the assessment. They started phase one. The $20,000 that's earmarked in FY20 is part of a phase two project in conjunction with a warrant article that also appropriates $20,000. So it indexes the records, they go through the records, we purge the records, they provide boxes and shelving that maximizing our total space, both upstairs in the vault, that allows us to access the records, and there's no space between the boxes. They're all uniform boxes and they fit right into the shelves. What we have now is we have shelving upstairs with boxes on them, but you can't get this like that much space on top of the boxes. That's just dead space.
And similar in the vault. Similar in the vault that the, right, the shelving is in.
So it's long overdue. We have, I would be happy to show anyone upstairs. It's just a mess. We need to do something about our record retention. The problem is we just don't have the physical space and we're trying to maximize what we have. This allows us to do that.
So the way that's affecting the CIP is actually the next year, the 2020 budget, the original request was $10,000 for book repairs. That's being increased to $20,000 for vault upgrades. At the moment, we have not increased or changed any of the out years of the CIP. Obviously, a future consideration on what we're going to do with that.
So we're putting off the book repairs for 1 year in order to get this project done, and then in 2021, the book repairs line item resumes.
It does resume. Okay, just so we're clear on that. Did I hear correctly, we're additionally going to have a warrant article?
Yes, there is a warrant article that appropriates $20,000 in the building improvements, like we do through the overlay. We have the last couple of years. There's a line item in there specifically for this project.
Okay, good. Just so everyone knows. Any questions on that? Ian? Go ahead.
There will be new shelving that's going in? Is that correct?
The shelving that's in the vault now, what they hope to do is take the new shelving, put it in the vault, and then use the shelving that's in the vault to put up in the attic.
Okay, is it fireproof shelving?
This is just metal shelving. Yeah, I would think that
it's metal fireproof. Shelving. It is the vault is fireproof downstairs.
Yeah, the vault is fireproof.
Yeah.
And the stuff that's in the vault needs to stay in the vault. But the stuff that's upstairs is just kind of on tables and not much.
I'm just asking, recently learned a lesson about fireproof shelving being very heavy, so I don't know if we need to do an assessment if things are in the attic in terms of weight.
That's something that Caleb is going to have to look at, but they thought that the span of how the shelving's going to go, they think that they'll be able to utilize that with what's up there.
Things will be scanned as well into software?
I think that's something we can look at in the future. I know when we scan now with the software we have and use that for our record retention. Some things have to remain paper copy, though, until the law changes. We especially payroll records and things of that nature, we have to keep perpetually, so.
Question, so you said that this $20,000 is phase two. Have we already started phase one?
It's not really.
We have $7,000 available, mm-hmm, that we use to have them come in, mm-hmm, to look at our records and to inventory it to see what could be purged, mm-hmm, is a way to minimize the amount of work that needs to be done.
So then this will be $20,000 from the CIP and then a warrant article. Will that take care of everything?
It should.
Thank you.
All right, no, that's good. Kim?
When this project is done, will the records be all in the vault in the two places instead of, you'll be able to fit everything in?
They should be, because whatever's upstairs, and once they go through there, there should hopefully be a lot of purging on that stuff. In the vault, there may be a little purging, but it'll be all, you know, on shelving that benefits the vault and in the boxes that will hopefully fit better. That's what we were told with the assessment.
But going forward, no change to the CIP at this point in time in what I'll call the out year.
No, not yet.
Good, okay. Any other questions on this? Great. Deb, thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Learning something about some of the warrant articles. I bring that up only because Dr. Bruneau will be coming up, and I've asked her as part of her presentation and Q&A on this to go over her warrant articles, just in brief, even though we don't have them in front of us yet. Eddie said we'll be getting an electronic copy sometime in the next day or so to start looking at a draft of that. Dr. Bruneau, podium is yours. Always a little presentation or
big presentation. Thank you, Mr. Chair, and members of the Finance Committee, Mr. Kazanovich and Mrs. Kwiatkowski. So thank you very much for having us here tonight. For those of you, hopefully everyone already knows, this is Cecilia Worsbicki, Business Manager. So on behalf of the Auburn School Committee and the leadership team in general, I thank you for the opportunity to present the FY20 budget for the Auburn Public Schools. This budget was created based on the vision, the mission, and the core values, just as we have done since those have been in place. We also drove all of our decision-making about this budget, and this is a slide that you have seen before because it's been in place since 2008. We've asked ourselves the question, how will this impact students and their achievement? That is, after all, our mission for being here as educators. Heavily throughout, you'll see reference to the strategic plan. So back in 2017, nearly 140 school and community representatives came together in Auburn Middle School cafeteria, similar to the 120 people that came together in November of 2013. And the question that they worked together to answer was, how will the Auburn Public Schools continue to evolve to ensure that our preschool through grade 12 students are prepared to meet the opportunities and challenges of a changing world? So this really was directed by the entire community of Auburn. Just for some background information and some demographic pieces. So you can see here that we've listed the free and reduced numbers as well as the enrollment by school. So you notice that the free and reduced percentages go from a low of 24% at the Packetchog School to a high of 32% at Auburn Middle School, for an average across the district of 27% of our students qualifying for free or reduced lunch. An additional piece of data is the fact that in these past 11 years, exclusive of the school choice students, we've seen a net gain of 185 students over the past 11 years. So in a time that many districts are seeing declining enrollments, the Auburn Public Schools are actually increasing in their numbers. Another piece that we really built this budget on was the social-emotional needs of our students. There is a direct connection between the social-emotional development of students and their academic learning and achievement. Whether students are struggling with anxiety, depression, homelessness, abuse, death, conflict, dysregulation, or all under the general umbrella of social-emotional, it oftentimes requires more support from individuals and professionals within the district. We also built this off of the priorities as set by the school committee and the leadership team, student safety always being paramount. So we looked here, the social emotional positions that I mentioned, so we're actually going to be adding a counselor at the Swanton Road Intermediate School. They currently have two for a population of just over 600 students, so we're going to bring that to three. And then also adding two district-wide social emotional support professionals. And we've been talking as a leadership team to determine what exactly those positions should be based on our students' needs. And it's looking right now, I'll be bringing this to the school committee next week, that likely could be licensed social workers and or licensed mental health counselors. And I actually had a conversation with Sally D'Arcangelo from Auburn Youth just to talk about her input, and she was very much in line with that thinking as well. Also, we have additions to our budget as required by IEPs, oftentimes to address students' safety needs. It's needing ABA support, applied behavior analyst, instructional assistant, or regular IA support. And then obviously funding to continue the work. There's not payment for our safety advisory team, but we do have a line item in our budget so that when they bring forward recommendations, we can implement them. Student achievement is second only to our students' safety. We believe the cornerstones, actually, of our district are really around continuous improvement and educational excellence. So to address a class size issue, which you'll see is another one of our priorities, we're actually going to be adding a grade 3 teacher and a grade 5 at Swanson. But what we're actually doing is we're taking a grade 2 teacher from Bryn Mawr and moving that individual, or moving that position up. The reason being there was a bubble of students over the past couple of years, you may remember, and that bubble is now going to grade 3. Grade 5, without the addition of that teacher, those classes would be over 25 students per class. Also, as required by the Department of Ed, we're going to be adding an English language tutor to meet the ratios and the time intensive support that they require for students who are still learning English. You'll see evidence in the budget of early college opportunities that we've had before, our preschool programming, and making sure that it minimizes financial barriers. We have before and beyond the school day programming, and also our unified sports program. Oftentimes, those students require IA or ABA support. As mentioned, the class size issue, school committee expectations is to have it below 25 at elementary and maintaining appropriate at middle and high. Technology, we're enormously appreciative of the support received from this board, the select board, Mr. Kazanovich, Ms. Jacobson, and town meeting in general, that we have the effect of a 1-to-1 ratio at grades 3 through 12, with basically a 1-to-2 ratio at the primary schools. At grades 3 through 5, however, those iPads do not go home, only at grades 6 through 12. In terms of textbooks, we want to make sure that our students have current materials in front of them, and the focus in this budget for next year is on social studies and history texts. The educator evaluation system, this is required by the Department of Ed. We have implemented this with gusto, working really closely with the teachers and administrators, and the learning walks that our administrators do to really calibrate our evaluative practices continue. Just as we expect our students to be held to high expectations and to achieve at high levels, so too do we expect the same of our staff. But in order to continually provide that, we need to provide professional learning opportunities for them. So you will see evidence of professional learning opportunities for staff. And then finally, the strategic plan implementation, as I started with, really driven by the 5 goals of teaching and learning, technology, community partnerships, health, wellness, and safety, and transitions as written back in November of 2018. So here is a summary of the new positions that we are adding, as noted previously. So at Swanson, we'll be a grade 5 teacher and a counselor. At Bryn Mawr, 3 ABAs, which are required by IEPs. You'll see at Bryn Mawr Impact, they're actually going to be sharing a permanent sub. This would be a person who is in the district between those two schools on a daily basis, getting to know those young students to provide that consistency that is really important, particularly at the primary level. We're really excited. I don't know if any of you were able to attend the Stringapalooza that took place on March 3rd. So 3 years ago, we implemented a strings program with our grade 3 students at the Swanton Road School. That group of students will actually go up to Auburn Middle School next year. So in order to keep the program going, we need to provide some support, and we're going to be creative in doing that. Eventually, we will need a staff member during the day dedicated to actually doing strings, but we're going to be able to piece it together for next year. It's a shared position of an LPN based on a child's medically fragile needs, and our preschool will need to bring someone in who will also part-time work as an ABA. The EL tutor I mentioned at Auburn Middle School, and then the two social-emotional support professionals that will be district-wide positions. As we do each year, we work really diligently to provide as many offsets in our budget to minimize the impact to the town of Auburn total. So as you can see here, over $2.7 million in offsets have been used. Those come from all available revolving accounts, school choice, Medicaid receipts, building rentals, athletic revolving, and the like. So in total, the FY20 request from the Auburn schools is $26,934,157, which represents a 4.2% increase over the FY19 amount. One thing I would say here too is the governor's budget that has come out so far, that's the only one that we have seen, includes an increase in Chapter 70 of just shy of $771,000. And also, I will tell you that there is an awful lot of talk at the State House among all members to really address funding and some additional funding for schools. There are a couple of different acts that are out there. It continues to get a lot of discussion, and I suspect that we actually may see some additional Chapter 70 monies, and that certainly is the hope. As we do each year, since we begin the budgeting process so early in the year and we don't have final numbers, we needed to make some assumptions, and these are in line with what we've done in the past. So we use our October 1 counts. Those have gone up or down, whether students have registered or withdrawn. We use our 240 grant, which is a special education grant, Title I and Title IIA, all as offsets. We anticipate $185,000 for Medicaid receipts. Our circuit breaker reimbursement we know to be $291,000. We're going to maintain the same number of school choice for a total of 82, 50 at the high school and 32 at the middle, and we use those monies as offsets in the budget. We've placed all our IAs and ABAs in their current roles, but we know there'll be some shifting because they'll actually go where students need them most. We've budgeted for 11 regular ed buses, just as we have done this year. We've used an offset of $100,000 from bus fees that will be collected. And again, we've used offsets in our satellite, Galaxy, Asteroids, Athletic Revolving, all of our accounts. So shifting now, with your permission, to the CIP. This is actually the FY20 CIP that we have amended a bit. You'll see here, noted in red, is we're actually proposing, school committee has approved, that we would remove $30,000 from the main entrance ADA accessibility at PAC. And the reason is because when we did the roof project at PAC with MSBA, we were able to do that as part of that project. So we're looking to repurpose that $30,000 towards the removal and reinstallation of a new one, underground oil tank at Swanson Road. So that $30,000 has shifted there. That really reflects the only change. Other than for central administration, we added window replacement as part of HVAC, but that was the only dollar shift that came. With regard to 2024, our overall request represents $845,000. And just as we have done, and tremendously appreciative of the support that we received from Town Manager Jacobson and CFO Kazanovich when we met, we did a little bit of shifting in some of these CIPs to stay in line with what they were asking, and school committee was happy to do so. You see here that we've addressed needs, including youth events at Bryn Mawr School, cafetorium, HVAC units, which would be rooftop there, some minor ongoing asbestos at Packachog. No money is designated for Swanson or Middle. the high school, some flooring upgrades, and also the O'Hara with asbestos management is needed, parking lot resurfacing, and replacement of scoreboards, and then playground upgrades district-wide. And then we've got our continued equipment items, both our iPad leases, copier leases, furniture, and such. Shifting next to the warrant articles, many of these are ones you've seen before. The first one is requesting the Medicaid reimbursements of $185,000. The second one, the number will be filled in once known closer to town meeting. This is the money from the trust, the Pappas Trust, to offset for site managers at the high school. The next one, the McKinney-Vento. So this was one, this is reimbursement that we get from the state for providing transportation for homeless students, whether it is to get them to our school or to return them to the school where they attended prior to becoming homeless. Typically, this has been a fall special town meeting, but last year, the monies came in prior to June 30th, so they went to the general fund. We don't know if they're gonna come in prior to June 30th or after, so we're putting this in here as a placeholder. Oh, that's just a duplicate, my apologies. Next one, this is a new one. So this is per Mass General Law, Chapter 71, Section 71F. We're hoping to establish a revolving account, and as noted here, it's for non-resident or foster care tuition students. What this would do, we explained to the selectmen the other evening, would allow an account to be set up so that if the school committee approved, either if we had exchange students come from another country, we did a very modified exchange with China about a year and a half ago, or if in our specialized special education programs, if we had open spots, we could accept students from other districts. If we did that, the intention would be only to accept them if we needed them to keep the program going. So if our numbers didn't become too small that we needed to eliminate it, and any monies received would be used to directly offset those programs. So just to bring in, because sometimes we're outreached by neighboring communities who have a very small number. Sometimes students' needs are so specialized that you can't create a program for just one child. So it's a way for us to be able to help with other districts, the intention being to use as offsets. And then we have two articles to repurpose CIP. So the first one is to repurpose $127,685. We want to use that for the underground oil tank removal. It's anticipated through Mr. Fahey that that will cost not only to remove the oil tank, but also to replace with a new one, approximately $280,000 to do that. So over a number of CIPs, ultimately we'll have enough in 2021 to do so. But this would actually be taking money from what was originally for PAC building rehab. And that's because with MSBA supporting with the 54.16%, we had to have all of the money up front. They reimburse us after the fact, so this is money available to be repurposed. And then finally, the remaining amount of $193,000, we propose to use $55,000 for a multifunction school activity bus and $78,000 to go towards the underground removal of the Swiss tank, and then $60,000 for Univent upgrades staying right at the Packachog School. So what I've given you is an awful lot of numbers and a lot of information to digest. But what I can tell you is what you see on the screen here is what it is all for. It is for our students. And we believe that as a district, it's really incumbent upon us to be sure that we're giving our students every potential opportunity so that they can excel, whether it's playing an instrument on the athletic field or court, artistically, academically, on the stage, or elsewhere. We really want to make sure that our kids have the very best opportunities possible. And as I always do, I close with a quote by Steve Jobs. So be a yardstick of quality. Some people aren't used to an environment where excellence is expected. Well, I can assure you that in the Auburn schools, we do expect excellence. Thank you for your support, and we're happy to answer any questions you may have.
Great, thanks, Dr. Brunel. In fact, I think what I want to do, given your presentation, is let's go backwards on this. I know we're not going to look at the warrant articles until next month, but while they're fresh and they were the last couple of slides, Are there any, just any quick questions for Dr. Brunel on those? I would prefer not to have her back when we do the warrant articles. If we can go through those first, and then maybe the CIP, and then the operating budget. So, Kim, if you don't...
Okay. Dr. Brunel, the funding for each of these articles, now, some are reimbursements. Can you run through where the money comes from?
Sure. So through the chair, the Medicaid article, that comes from reimbursement. So those are for services we've provided, and then they're reimbursed to the town, so we need to ask for them directly. In terms of the, in these articles, these aren't the actual number. These are the ones that we sent up. They'll be renumbered. The money for the Auburn High School gymnasium, this comes from the trust fund, so that's interest earned, and we use that for site manager costs. The next one, the McKinney-Vento, that likewise comes to the town directly as a reimbursement based on whatever claim we put in. And unfortunately, the state doesn't reimburse us in full for our homeless transportation. But whatever percentage they do, it goes to the town, so we need to request that money.
So usually about 30 to 34% of what we pay out.
And this is a duplicate of it. My apologies. So this one here, there's no money attached to it. It's really just to set up a revolving account for the non-resident students, so there's no funding being requested for that. And then the remaining two articles is repurposing previously approved CIP funds.
So there's no additional appropriation?
Correct, correct.
It's hard to see from here, so, okay, thank you.
Absolutely.
To be clear, these are draft right now. I know they still have to go through town council, so that may adjust a little bit anyway.
Correct.
And I did notice in your original CIP that you did have $280,000 in there in 2024 for replacing the central administration oil tank, which didn't make the final cut.
Right.
I certainly understand and appreciate that, but I think that goes back to your comment that this is a $280,000 tank replacement at Swanson Road School, right?
Correct.
You don't have natural gas available for that site?
We don't, and in fact, we'll be removing the underground tank up at Packagock, and that will cost $80,000 because we do have gas there, so we don't need to replace the tank. The problem at Swanson is we need to replace the tank.
Any other questions? And once again, if there's any follow-up stuff, especially on these warrant articles, I believe you're okay to take emails directly from anyone here.
Absolutely. And if you want us to come back, I'm happy to do that, too.
I would
either way.
Prefer not to, and
okay.
Hopefully that gets in front of that.
Great.
You were just here the other night, too. Any other questions for the moment on the warrant articles? Okay. Let's go back to this. Ed?
Just one comment.
Sure.
Just something that came to my attention when Dr. Brunel was making her presentation. In terms of the school committee's vote in their request of $26,934,157, that represents a 4.2% increase over current fiscal year. Our recommendation originally back to Dr. Brunel was 4.25. So there is a $14,011 difference between our recommendation and what Dr. Brunel is presenting tonight. They did inform us after we made our recommendation that the school committee acted and reduced the budget down to 4.20. We did not make that change, and it was an oversight. So we need to adjust this figure to match what Dr. Brunel has presented tonight. That being said, I'd like to change the town manager's recommendation to reflect $26,000,009.
Regular budget, right?
Excuse me?
The operating budget, yes.
I thought we were on capital.
Yeah, it's all right.
It's all right, but I just wanted,
Ed,
before the question started, I just wanted to make that note. $26,934,157.
I caught that, Eddie.
I wanted to get it. Yeah.
And we assume Dr. Brunel is okay with that at this point in time.
We are, yes.
It does look like a lot of positive things may be coming out of Beacon Hill regarding whatever formula changes they're going to make. I know it held up approving the budget last summer, and someone didn't have enough backbone to finish the job. Hopefully they get it done.
Sure.
A lot of towns could use that. I will open up to any questions on the CIP. Once again, I had seen something in the original CIP that they had removed. But if there are any questions on the, I'll call it the current year, 2020, or on 2024, feel free to open up on this. Dr. Brunel.
So with my apology, when I said to you, I'm seeing here Article 3 is written twice, that is actually an error. So there is what should be Article 4, and there is no funding required for this. What we're seeking is authorization under Mass General Law, Chapter 30B, Section 13, to enter into a contract in excess of 3 years' duration, because soon we'll be going back out for bus contract. And it is our belief, and data I think shows, that if we can go for a five-year contract, we get a better price. So we will be requesting that, but there's no funding requested to it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Tough oversight on that one. Okay, back to the CIP. Thanks for the correction there. Any questions on the CIP as presented? I got a couple of clarifications that I'm looking for. The stabilization funding that went to the replacing the football field or the all-purpose field, mm-hmm. that's a 2020 appropriation, $300,000. And the remaining amount, how much? Do we have a final number on the replacement of that? It looked like there was something regarding the track around it, 120 some odd thousand, 2023, I think.
So that is through the, Mr. Chair, that is later. So the actual cost, the bid that we received is for $425,000 to replace the field. So our intention is to do that this summer. We've worked with Mr. Kazanovich. We'll have the $300,000 down payment from stabilization, and then we'll be financing it for 3 years and paying it out of the CIP, the remaining balance.
And how much a year will that be, the remaining balance?
54. It's just shy of 54,000.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I got a little confused in trying to understand what was going on with that. Okay. Any other questions on the CIP? Good. That's great. Let's go to the operating budget. I will say I did reach out to Dr. Brunel, and thanks for replying with requesting a couple extra comments in anticipation of normal questions that come from us. So her presentation tonight addressed at least everything I could think of. So thank you for doing that, Dr. Brunel.
Welcome.
So as Ed corrected us, we do have an adjusted budget, I guess, or revised budget. And that total is $26,934,157, which represents a 4.20% increase. It was not the school committee's initial budget. Certainly was higher than that. A question I have on that is, you mentioned something about a student with some incredible special needs. You had also mentioned in your original budget, you'd recently heard of a student that was going to require $125,000 as part of that just come up. Is that student still coming in, and that's still integrated into what is the current budget?
So in this budget, we have reflected every student that we are aware of currently. The great thing, and thank you to the Finance Committee, Select Board, and School Committee, we now have that Special Education Stabilization Fund that if an unanticipated and unbudgeted special ed need arises, we have almost $325,000 in that account for that purpose. So, but this budget does reflect every student that we know of currently.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes.
Any other questions? Student population? School numbers, that kind of thing.
Oh, go ahead. No, go ahead.
Ed?
Question about the, thanks for providing first the enrollment numbers. I like seeing those, and I like seeing that they're very stable. My other question is regarding contracts. Where are we on, and what year are we on the teacher contracts and other contracts?
So for next school year, I meant to look at this too. So teachers are not until the following school year. This year we've just completed cafeteria workers. So I believe next year we will be looking at custodians, secretaries, and IAs. And we have built a percentage into this budget to be able to do those negotiations.
Okay, thank you.
Ed?
Dr. Bunnell, on the school choice, I noticed that the number of students for 18 is going up to 82. Is there like a rough number on how much reimbursement we get for those students?
So for a student who does not have special needs, we get $5,000 per student. And the state does do an adjustment if the child has special needs that cost additional money, so we get that amount. But we get $5,000 per student. And the number that you saw in the presentation is stable from last year and this year, and will be for next year as well.
How about when you look at the number, it looks like you're growing about 25% over a five-year average. Is there like a vision over the next 3 to 5 years on where that number is going to continue to grow to? Because I'm thinking more of, if we're getting 5,000 per student, does that cover the cost of those to educate those students?
So through the chair, that's a great question. I don't want to speak for the school committee, but I can tell you what my recommendation would be to the school committee. I think really right now that unless we were to see some enrollment declines, that we would not be making recommendations to add any school choice students. So these students are only at the middle school and high school. We don't have any school choice at the elementary, because really those classes, we want them to be lower than they currently are. So I think that number will stay stable, or if anything, may decline. But we really pay attention very closely to our Auburn students and make sure that it's not in any way negatively impacting them. The one thing that I would say is, where we've added in school choice students, it has not required us, so say at the middle school, the 32 students that are spread across the three grades, it doesn't require us to bring in any additional teachers. It just makes the class sizes to be more appropriate. So rather than at 17, they might be at 20 instead, which is still a manageable number. So we really try to gauge it closely.
Thank you.
Okay, any other questions? Kevin?
Mine was gonna be relative to school choice as well. Can you just describe it's only the middle school and high school, but can you describe what the process is, and are there any concerns as far as that goes? And, you know, again, it's very rough math, but I just took the total budget and divided it by the enrollment of the district. You know, it comes out to about 10,000 per student, if you that way, and you're saying it's 5,000. Can you just explain a little
bit? So the process for school choice is, it's a random application. People come in and apply. They actually were accepting applications through March 31st, and we'll do a random blind lottery acceptance selection of them. We have, over the years, in response to questions from school committee, and we just want to make sure that we are doing our due diligence, because when we accept school choice students, we don't see what their transcript is, we don't see what their attendance rate is, their behavior, or any issues like that. But I've done studies four times over the past numerous years and looked at the school choice students that we were accepting. And the categories we looked at were their attendance rate, their grades, their participation in extracurricular activities, and there's one more category. In every one of those categories, our school choice students did as well as, or in some cases slightly better than, the students in Auburn. So, but it is true, we could accept a student who could require an out-of-district placement, because it's a blind lottery that we accept them. But the money that we accept in, I guess I would state again, the money that we accept in, because our per pupil rate is really about $13,000 per student, per DESE, but the $5,000 that we get in, we use it as an offset in our budget, and it's not required us to bring in additional teachers and things. So we're able to absorb them partially, I would say. I don't know if that answers your question.
It does, and you addressed some of the other concerns, but I mean, and I appreciate that you've looked at how they've performed over the years, but have we just had extraordinary luck over the last four times? I mean, is that that we're gonna end up with someone that's a disciplinary issue that needed to get out of that district, or are we gonna end up with we roll the dice every time we do that lottery and just kind of hold our breath and hope we do well?
Well, so interestingly, the Mass Association of School Committees worked with the Department of Ed, and they just conducted it. They haven't actually released the study yet. They looked at school choice students that are accepted across the state, And one of the things that they found, and it's still in draft form, is that typically, not always, but typically, school choice students are ones that are, in fact, performing better in their districts because most times, and it's the case in Auburn, transportation is not provided. So it requires an additional commitment on the part of parents to get the child to school. When they're involved in after-school activities and things, that's also expected and required. But that seems to be the trend across the state, at least according to this preliminary draft data. So.
If we take a student who ends up being a disciplinary issue within the school,
correct. So once the child is accepted as school choice, he or she is eligible to remain into the Auburn Public Schools until graduation. And what I would say, too, is of the 82 students that we have currently, we'll only be accepting. So at one time, we had the same number of students per grade. That shifted a little bit because per state law and school committee policy, that once a child's accepted for school choice, his or her sibling is given preference. So that skewed how many we have per grade. But we'll actually only be adding a handful of new school choice students because we keep the numbers stable. So at the high school, only the seniors will be leaving. Everybody else shifts up. So we'll be adding some at the middle school, and occasionally we add some at the high school, depending if sometimes students will leave, you know, mid-year, and we wait to replace their position at the start of the next school year.
So even if you accepted a middle school choice student who had younger siblings, we're not putting any into our elementary?
Correct. They're only accepted in once they reach middle school. Mm-hmm. Correct. Yes. You're welcome.
Any other questions? Just a reminder for everyone listening at home, part of looking at the school budget is the Finance Committee can ask questions on anything, operating budget. We're basically voting up or down the final requested number, in this case, the 26,934,157. Which is just a little bit off the town manager, and for all sorts of good reasons that's been adjusted on that. So we don't necessarily get into school by school budgets anymore on this. I don't believe there's a value added to this in terms of one school's budget last year versus this year. I know back when I was a parent with kids in those schools, there was a Bryn Mawr teacher that, you know, took care of at least one of my kids. I was always interested in that. Well, it's not important anymore. It's the overall school district. So that's why we're not getting into those numbers unless there was a specific question. So it's not school-centric. Mm-hmm. Just to underline that, and it is different than the rest of the budget process that we undertake. Kevin?
Just a staffing question. So as we learned, or I've learned more about the overall costs of pensions and benefits and how they affect the town, not in a single budget year, but over the long term. You know, each year we get a couple more from the school department, throughout other departments, but mm-hmm. school department certainly more than others. Mm-hmm. Is that something that you take into consideration when you do these positions, whether you're looking for, you know, 40-hour positions or 27 and a half hour positions where we can pay them, provide services, but, you know, save us the long-term cost?
We really do. One thing I would say is we're a bit confined with the number of hours in a school day. So by bringing an individual in, typically they're working 30 or 32 and a half school hours, which then makes them benefit eligible. But I would say that I think that we have over the years been very conscientious in putting forth budget requests that really do reflect needs that we have as opposed to wants and things. So in full recognition that beyond what is reflected in this budget, there are additional costs for the town and things. So we do recognize that, but believe that these positions are needed, and if possible, if we've ever been able to, we have done the less than 20 hours per week, if possible.
The other thing just to add is sometimes it balances out where they might not take the health benefits. We've had a lot of cases where new teachers have come in and not taken mm-hmm. the option.
And just one more question, and it kind of relates to another, we'll have Auburn Youth and Family Service come in a couple weeks. And I was part of the strategic plan. Thank you for that. It was a great experience. Social, emotional, big, went across every group that we had. That was a big concern. So I, you know, I'm glad to see that you've got two professionals coming in full-time. But historically, Auburn Youth and Family sort of helped the school department with some of those needs. Are those needs still going to be there for the Auburn Youth and Family? Or are we now plugging in two separate places?
So, through the chair, that's a great question. I fully anticipate, I just met recently with Sally, that we will still require their services. In fact, what you'll hear, I think, when they come and do their presentation, that already as of the end of February, beginning of March, they have fulfilled their contractual hours and still will continue to provide support. So, you know, it is not a tremendous number of students that require support, but the students that require support require very intensive support. So currently Auburn Youth is supporting 30 students at the high school and 19 at the middle school. Even if we add two district-wide positions, they'll certainly be able to take over some of those, but Auburn Youth is still very much going to be needed. And we also contract at no cost to us. U Inc. actually brings in counselors, and that's done directly with individuals' health insurance that pays them directly. So it's really a triage method, I would say. So what we're adding will certainly help, but I fully anticipate we'll still need Auburn Youth support. Welcome.
Okay, anyone else? Kim?
Eddie, seeing we were just talking about health and retirement benefits, what's the average employee benefit cost? Do you have an average number?
No, we don't have an average number. Certainly we use a percentage based upon level of pay because it varies. benefits normally run like 30 to 38% of pay. I can tell you that the health insurance ranges from a single plan employer contribution of about $6,000 as high as an employer contribution on a PPO of close to $20,000. So there's a wide range there, all depending on the plan. So it is an expensive increase. It's a benefit, it's a personnel cost that we have to absorb when we bring in new hires. We certainly provide for that based upon what Dr. Brunel has presented tonight. We know that there are a number of new positions that has been built into the budget that won't come as a surprise to us, but it is and the employee benefits portion of our budget is a large, large cost. That's something we have to deal with on a annual basis. We know we're trying to contain costs as best we can. We have a very successful health trust right now with $10 million in it. We're paying for actual claims, not on a premium basis, saving the town hundreds of thousands of dollars a year, because on a premium basis, you're paying that premium regardless of the amount of claims that you incur. That's why we're able to build up the trust. We're using that healthy balance in the trust to help contain costs in future years. But as you well know, OPEB is a large cost too. It's a long-term liability that we have to deal with. That's not going away. We just had an actuarial study update as a result of our annual audit. That liability went down from $56 million down to $26 million. That's good news. It dropped significantly only because of the discount rate of future dollars. So they take what we have in the trust, they look at our funding plan, they're calculating that on a return on that money, which they're estimating now at 7%. They did it at 4.5%. That gap in itself dropped that liability by $30 million. It could go up again if that discount rate changes. So that's something that we take very seriously, and we're trying to address annually by that annual appropriation and through our contractual discussions that we're having with the unions right now.
Any other questions? My one last comment is, if Beacon Hill takes care of our education needs across the state, pencils might need to be sharpened again, because we're going to have to try to figure that out sometime before town meeting, I guess, supposedly. I'm guessing they're going to come up with something, and that'll hopefully be some extra dollars in to our budget, and then we've got to work that into our fall true-up to what we really need.
Yeah, I don't think we'll be in a position to make any adjustments prior to the annual, but certainly, I think at the fall, that's when we will resume discussions and see how much flexibility we have.
Okay. Anyways, we've got a department and town manager, I guess, request of $26,934,157. This is a $1,084,595, or 4.2% increase over prior year. Do we have a motion on this budget?
Motion to recommend.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? So voted. Great.
Thank you very much, Dr. Brunel. Thank you.
Dr. Brunel, I assume regarding the Norfolk situation, is that something you can answer questions to, or is that more just a numeric question for Eddie on this? If you want to give us an update, obviously there's been a pretty wild change in this budget, and what's going on with that, so.
I think simply put, net gain of 2.
Okay. I know we've got to be a little...
That includes tuition or assessment as well as transportation.
Okay.
Two more people.
Wow. So there's 3 definite, 1 pending, it looks like. That one is still pending, right? So more likely than not, we'll have a net gain of 2, and we built that into the budget. So certainly if 1 or 2, for whatever reason, do not attend, we will come back and amend that budget to reflect that reduction.
And that budget request is $111,000 even, and that's including the anticipated 2 additions.
Right, I think it was 110 and change. We rounded up to 1.
It's a rounded number, yeah. Just so everyone's clear on that, and that represents a $47,000 increase. Obviously, no additional transportation costs. They'll be carpooling, right? That's what it sounds like.
Well, yeah. Right now we have a...
Whatever that situation
right now
is.
We contract with a group collaborative, and so for the next year, we have like a 3-year contract for the transportation, and we have 2 buses currently, and so we each district, whoever's participating pays, okay. They split the cost that way per district, so it's broken down. So the transportation costs will not change for next year.
Kim?
Dr. Brunel, can you, for the audience, explain what this is? In case they don't know.
Sure. So we have our students go to our sister school, I'll call it, is Bay Path Regional. So if a student wants to participate in a program that Bay Path does not offer, they get to, and these students are participating in animal science programming that's available at Norfolk Aggie Agricultural. So that's the reason that they're able to attend there. They need to be accepted by the program, and that's why 2 of them are still pending.
We should know officially by April whether they're accepted, and then it'll depend upon in the fall whether they actually decide to attend or not, but we'll know for sure.
All right. Yep.
Just back to a little bit back to the school choices. So how much are we paying per student to go to Norfolk?
So is it about 23,000?
Yeah, it's a little short of 23,000.
Mm. It kind of goes to our, you know, we're bringing kids in for 5,000, we're sending kids out for 20,000, but.
We don't have an option. I mean.
I understand.
Yeah. We should start an animal science program, I think, is your point, and I agree.
No. All right, that's great. Thank you both for that.
Thank you.
Yeah, there's not too much else to say on this, correct?
Okay. Thank you,
Dr. Brunel. Good to see you both.
Thank you.
Any other comments that are, let's just say, okay enough for public TV regarding this $47,000 increase, that's 74%?
Motion to recommend $111,000 line item.
Reluctant second.
All right. No more comments, please. Yeah. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? So voted. Thank you. Thanks, Amy. Okay, our last budget tonight is the Bay Path budget. It's a very small increase in the budget. I didn't think it was worth bringing in John LaFlesh and Dean Akabuchi in on this. The amount requested for the Bay Path budget is $1,074,885. That represents just under an $18,000 increase, or 1.69%. I'll open up to any comments or questions. I'm not sure Ed can answer much of anything on this, but it is a final budget, right?
All depending on, this is using the governor's.
Oh, okay.
So it could change, depending on level of transportation reimbursement and their Chapter 70.
Fine. So this would be, well, I'll open up to any comments or a motion. Kev?
I understand this is a set, you know, there's not much here, but can you just, for my reminders and people watching, like, how do we come up, the Cliff Note version, how do we come up with this number? Is it based on number of students? How does the Bay Path formula work?
I'll tell you, it's a very complex formula. It includes a capital portion, because we're paying an assessment based upon our share of the new school, which was about $3-some-odd million. It takes into consideration the community's wealth factor. It takes into consideration the community's enrollment.
Enrollment in the school?
Enrollment of students.
And do you know how many students Auburn is currently sending?
84. And there's two more in the proposal.
Right. Current year is 84, and they showing 86. Oh, no, I'm sorry. Yeah, FY20, they're showing 86. FY19, 84. Mm-hmm. Difference of two.
Is their enrollment up? Vocational
in total?
In total. Are they doing well? I mean, seems statewide there is
a net gain of 11.
Net gain of 11. I believe they're full up, is what I'm told.
I believe they are, too.
Turning away. If you go to page 14, there's some enrollment stats on that. I know there's a lot of pages. They always provide just an incredible amount of information, but they're dealing with how many member communities. So,
actually, on 15, there's a profile for Auburn there. It has the assessment broken out.
Eddie, that debt service number, that's for the override thing, right?
It wasn't an override. The override failed. We're raising that through general taxation. That in itself is for the new school.
Mm-hmm. I thought there was an override.
There was a local override that failed, and then there was a collective override
that passed.
Because it wasn't presented as a debt exclusion, we had to raise it through through general fund revenues.
How many years is our commitment to Bay Path? Do we have, how many years out do we agree as part of this regional consortium? Seems like vocational schools are the sort of the trend and way things are trending for high school education. It seems it went away from it for a long time. No one wanted that was not the place to go. But now, there's outstanding students. It's a competitive place to go. You see a point that either Bay Path expands to accept more students, or, 10 years from now, are we looking to bring some of these things back in-house? Accomplish them on our own.
Legally, I don't know the term, nor if there's an opt-out provision within that agreement. I'm not familiar with the language of that agreement, but I know it's been in place for years.
Wasn't it a legislative?
Yeah.
Mandated back in the early 70s, late 60s, that's how far back that goes.
I think it was a state legislative, so you don't get out of that.
Without legislative.
Without legislation. It's not like you can say, oh, we're not going to pay this year, so.
Right.
My understanding too, it's very expensive to educate a student at a vocational school, much more expensive than at a high school that's non-vocational. So, I mean, thinking of bringing them back would be a huge expense, just to set up capital, et cetera.
Yeah, my understanding on this, if you're looking on this page 14, that for freshmen incoming to Bay Path, Auburn has the ability to send 48 students there, and I know we've got a total of 86, so obviously we're not using all of our allotment there, and I believe, even though it's competitive on there, we are, I think, guaranteed. I'm not sure on that, but it's, once again, it's very competitive to get in there.
Yeah.
And I think we can add to that. You know, they got to pass certain tests to get in there. I know some parents back in the day complained to me saying it's supposed to be an alternative to Auburn High School, and I'm like, yeah, but it's doesn't mean it's a right to go there. So there's been some question on that. They keep winning more and more awards for both academic and vocational stuff. So
sports.
In sports, yeah. It's just they've done a great job. John LaFletch has done a great job with that.
I got to tell you, John and Dean have done a fantastic job. They keep the pencil sharp. They're barely above the minimum contribution. And they can go above the minimum contribution if they so choose. But they're trying to contain costs. And I think that's reflective in the assessment. If you look back, it's grown very modestly. At times when other school districts are increasing 4 or 5%, they're increasing at 1% or less. So, Ian, to follow up on your comments, if you do the ratio of students to assessment, it's about $12,500.
I guess we normally give Bay Path a pass, but maybe considering next year, you know, as this whole vocational world seems to be blossoming, exploding, maybe bring them in and like to hear what their, you know, not only the numbers and the things, because it sounds like that's kind of locked in, but just where they see the program going in the future, you know, how it's going to affect us.
Oh, absolutely. And anytime we've asked them to come in, you know, half the time was to defend their numbers, and the last few times was to let them just, you know, get up on their soapbox and say, we've got some great programs here, and they're absolutely right. The fact that they're turning students away just tells me, hey, look, they've got the ability to be both cherry picking to a certain extent students going in there, and if students aren't shaping up in there, throwing them out, because there's other people trying to get in there. It's great for, I'll say, a competitive school district, both academically and vocationally. So, and that's a far cry from when I was going through school and the perceptions then back in the 70s. It's a great change. It really is, and a great asset to the community. I know, Lionel was saying the other night with the proposed work that we're going to try to do on Gleason to try to bring in some of the you know, apprentices down Bay Path to help out on that. That'd be a great project for them to do for the community. Trevor?
Yeah, I know too that they use the students as much as possible too to help out with different community projects you mentioned, and then the new facility itself too is gorgeous.
Yeah.
And day and night compared to what it was prior to the renovation.
Yeah. It was an older, tired school. I mean, we know all about it here. We just fixed all of ours. So the timing on that was a little probably not good. We were in the middle of fixing all of ours. But it does look like the debt service is going down every year for us. So that's kind of nice anyways. We're getting down closer to $200,000 a year just for the debt service for Auburn.
Can we ask them to consider adding an agricultural program to their
Yeah.
Sounds like there's a demand in the area for filling buses to go there.
Well, I'll tell you what, I bet you if we send Dr. Brunel, she'll be the first one to say, let's do this. All right, any other questions or comments on this? And we'll try to remember to bring them in next year just to hear what's going on with the programs there. It has been several years since they've been in.
Motion to approve.
Thanks, Kim.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, so voted. Thank you. All right, that's the last budget we have tonight. Next week, I believe so far, we've got Veteran Services, Town Hall, General Services, and Emergency Preparedness, unless there's anything else coming in.
Reserve, law, maturing debt, interest, employee benefits.
All right. A whole bunch more exciting budgets going on. Once again, we should all be getting at least a draft of the warrant articles. What I'd like to do is everyone to take a look at those, even though they're draft, to see whether you think they have a financial impact or not, whether we defer on them. It'll help move along our April 10th meeting. I believe on the 10th, Youth Commission will be in, and the warrant articles, and that should be all we've got scheduled that night.
Capital.
In approving the capital plan. So that's how the next 2 weeks should go. We'll be all set to go for May 6th or 7th annual town meeting. Very exciting. Anything else? All right, I'll accept a motion to adjourn then.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, so voted. Thanks, good night.